before we start today's lecture, let me go over to the whole course and what are you expecting and how you're going to conduct the whole course. So can we have the slides, please? Okay. So as you've been already introduced to me and Professor Pratihar, I am in the Department of Electrical and Computer Engineering at Michigan State University. This is a city called East Lansing, about 1.5 hour away driving from Detroit, city of Detroit, and Lansing is the capital of Michigan, so we are right there at the capital of the state. We are very north, so it's pretty cold during the winter time, and that gives us a lot of time to stay inside and work. So we have plenty of time to work than other places. But summertime is really good. Now the weather is very nice, and there is a lot of outdoor activities. And I'm also a visiting professor here in the mechanical and computer engineering, and also in the computer science department. My position is for 5 years, which started last year. So this is my second visit. Before I go to Dilip, let me just say that I was a student here a long time ago, from 81 till 85. Then I worked in Engineers India Limited in New Delhi. It's a petrochemical organization for design of the whole petrochemical plant. So I had a really nice exposure working in many design problems. After working for about 1.5 to couple of years, I decided to go for higher studies. Then I moved to US and did my master's and PhD. But then I wanted to come back and practice my teaching career here. So I joined IIT Kanpur, because Kharagpur had a lot of nice memories for my being here as a student, and I didn't want to spoil it. So I went to a different place. But I enjoyed my stay in Kanpur. There are a lot of nice facilities over there, and the students, very dedicated students, which I had the opportunity to work with. So I spent about 20 years working there before moving to US only about 4 years ago. So I'm basically an Indian and just recently moved out. So I'm happy that there is this scheme for me to come back and do something for India. So I'll keep on coming, hopefully, every year, at least for a couple of weeks. But it's getting a bit of a crunch of time, because that's really my main place now. And I have about 11 PhD students and 3 postdocs. So many people and so many other activities, projects that I have, it's very difficult to take 2 weeks out. But in the summer, I have told myself that I have to do this. I have to come for 2 weeks, so I keep aside everything and come for it. So please try to take good stock of the time. And let us make it interactive. My purpose would be not to finish all the thing you have here in the proceedings. This I've just kept in case there is no question, no interaction. I'll just go and do my job and go back. Okay. But even if I spend half of it, you ask me so many questions that I have the chance to do only half, I'll be most happy person, right? So the idea would be to for you to understand at least few things that I put over here. Coming back to Dilip, I mentioned was my first PhD student, and then he had an illustrious career working at various places, eventually being here for quite some time now. He had his promotions very quickly because of his work, and he's got quite many students been working on PhD. So he's been also doing optimization and multi-agent systems quite a bit. He's written quite a few books in this. This course, mostly, since I'm doing it for the first time, Dilip and I decided to do most of the teaching myself. And then one of the days, he's going to talk about interactive and visualization methods for optimization, which is also a very important thing. All right, so here are email addresses for both of us. So you have the proceedings, and you have all these things. The way I would suggest you to do is, you will have this with you, right, by the time you leave. So keep all your notes onto this. There are white spaces around, so keep all the notes around it. So don't keep it in some other place so that everything is here. And don't ever lose it, okay? Keep it all the way till you need it. All right, so moving to the next slide. What's happening? Okay, let's just go through the general structure of the whole course. Today is a little exception because we had the inauguration and we started a little late. One thing I'd like to look at is that I saw some of you came 10, 15 minutes later than when it's supposed to be. So let's not do that from now on because we have limited time. So 9:30, we're going to start. Please come at least 5 or 10 minutes before and wait outside in case you have to, so that as soon as it's 9:30, we can start, okay? And then in the afternoon, we're going to start at 2 to 3:30. We'll be solving problems in the afternoon, and the assignment problems are, I think, given at the back. Most of the days, if there's any change, I'm going to let you know. So the way we'll do that is I will briefly explain before you start doing the assignments of what you should do. And the assignments will be based on what we cover either that day morning or the previous days. So you'll have exposure to the material for doing the home assignments, the assignments here. And if you cannot solve it for some reason, I will ask you to take it home. Home means to wherever you're staying here, and next day you can bring it. So you need to submit the assignments on a piece of paper which you're not providing. So you have to have your own papers to work on them. You can use your pen or pencil. Need not have to be typed or anything, okay? So when you submit them. Today there is an exception again. We are going to start at 3 p.m. Instead of 2 p.m. today, okay? So because we are a little late and I need to leave at 12 for another appointment, but so 3 o'clock, only exception today, but tomorrow onwards we will start at 2 p.m. So we'll go from 3 to 4:30 today. I hope it's okay with everybody, right? So in the same room. There are 4 quizzes. We're not going to take any more final exam, okay? So it's a continuous evaluation. Because if a final exam means you will only look at before the exam, and that's not going to serve the purpose, so I thought of distributing it. So take each quiz very seriously because that goes towards your evaluation. Okay. Again, any change I'm going to mention to you. So this slide you don't have because I just added today, but this is just for you. I thought I should have one slide on the objectives of this course. So there are a few objectives that we have so that you see where we are going. First of all, you will understand what is the scope of optimization in practice. So why is optimization needed? What are the problems in practice where optimization is needed? Both Professor Saha and Das talked about in the inauguration about the importance of it. I will show you a laundry list of various problems. One of the thing with optimization is that there is no boundary, there is no discipline where it belongs. Okay, I had my formal training in mechanical engineering. But there are I get students from computer science, I get students from aerospace, from business school, actually. So I do such a course in a university in Finland called Aalto University. It's actually Aalto University School of Business, although there is engineering school. But business school thought their students should know optimization. Just this summer, it's not yet finished. Last couple of weeks, I have been video shooting on an MBA course on where a module is the optimization module. That is an MSU course. It will be an online course, but unfortunately, you will not have access to that because this is a proprietary thing. But why I'm telling you is that this is not only restricted to engineering. We optimize in many different problem areas. So you will get a good idea of the scope. So I want you to understand that because many of you will be eventually working in a company or will become a professor and you may be coming from different backgrounds, different fields. Optimization is one common thing that binds all of us, you will see. So I want you to understand that. Then there will be certain properties that the corresponding optimal solution will have. And it's good to understand what are these properties because many people in industry don't know that. Many people, many students even, who has not taken a course like this know that. So they think, okay, I have used a code downloaded from somewhere, and I have applied into my problem, and I got a solution, that must be the optimal solution. But no, optimal solutions have certain properties, so we'll go through them. Unfortunately, those properties are mathematical properties, okay? Fortunately or unfortunately? Unfortunately, I say because many of you may not be very math-savvy, maybe liking math too much. So that's why I say unfortunate. But you need to know, for those of you, need to know a little bit of math. But it's not a very hi-fi math. Your 12th standard math is good enough. Like how to compute gradients, hope you remember. I'll try to keep it restricted to polynomials so that you want to get the idea and not really do research and optimization from today. And a little bit of geometry, which I'm going to be talking about a little more. So not much is needed here, but you cannot avoid math and a little bit of geometry unless, you know, if you want to understand what makes the solutions optimal. So that's something I want you to know. I don't want you to know them as very descriptive course, okay? There should be some something finite and something that is more definitive. Then the third point, I want you to understand the certain methods of doing optimization. There are codes. We are trying to see if, okay, how many of you have your own laptop here? Okay, about 50, not even 50%. Okay, we are trying to see if the computer system that they have there can be used. So if it is, then we will go through some MATLAB experience of doing optimization. If not, then those of you have laptops, you can bring it on the next week, the following week when we get there. I will otherwise demonstrate it on my computer. So when you go back to your place and you have an access to computer, you can, and if you have MATLAB, you can do it. But at least I want you to understand some of the optimization methods. So that's not a mandatory thing. There won't be any quiz questions from MATLAB or anything, but this is for you to know. And then the fourth thing I want you to know is understand their role, the optimization role for finding stuff that goes beyond just the optimal solution. So, you know, as I mentioned, the name of the course has this word innovation in it. I want you to think that you can innovate. All you need to know is now who is going to guide me, what kind of methodologies. Do I have a textbook by which I can learn how to innovate? Unfortunately, there is no such book yet. But I strongly feel it's a possibility. We can teach how to do innovation. And innovation is everything these days. Any company you join, any place you work, unless you're innovating, you are nobody. You don't need master's and PhD students unless you can innovate. Everybody can be done with polytechnic background or at most a bachelor's degree background if you want to do just run-of-the-mill stuff. But they hire graduate students thinking that they will come up with new ideas. So where does the ideas come from? You are designing, you're working in a company. The company produces something, let's say gearbox, every day. So how are you going to design something new? Well, all you are taught in your undergraduation, if that's the only degree you have, is how to design a gearbox. It doesn't tell you how to come up with a new gearbox, which may be better in terms of compactness, in terms of its performance, noise-free. There are different things you can have, but you're not exposed to those things. So you wonder, how am I going to design something new, right? And that's a common question that only undergrads have. So this is a motivation for those of you who are just working on your bachelor's to think about doing higher studies, because higher studies means master's and PhD provides you a unique platform to specialize on certain areas, right? And there you are not taught exactly how to design a gearbox in any way, but you are trained, your brain is kind of nurtured in that direction to start thinking in a new way. Okay, so there are methodologies to do that. And hopefully in this course you will get some of that exposure. Okay, but it will not be enough for you to start innovating, but this is just an exposure. You still need the domain background. So you still need your, if you're a naval architecture students, you need that background. If you're aerospace students, you need that background. But you need additionally more that can only come from your master's and PhD program, okay? So hopefully you'll get a flavor of that. I think you will have enough information for you to know some of these things and go back and say, okay, I'm working on these things, either on my PhD topic, and here is something, I want to create something new. He told us a few things, so it could be a good start for you to get a hold of a software, get a hold of a method, and get some new concepts from this course. So that's my objective of this course that we'll have. Prerequisite, as I said, again, this one you don't have, but if you want, you can note it down. You need to know gradient a little bit, as I mentioned. The 2D geometry a little bit. If I give you a function of x, y, can you plot it? That kind of geometry knowledge, okay? any programming knowledge will be great, but in this course, I had a talk with Dilip before framing this course, and he told me that getting computer may be a little difficulty, so I didn't put that part here. But now we are seeing some opportunities, so next time I do, I'll probably put more programming into the course, but this course, you're not doing it, so you need not have to know. But if you know any programming language, that's going to be helpful, because some of the algorithms we're talking about, you can in the evening sit in your hostel room and try to code it, you know, and then see what's happening. So I think you try to utilize your time the maximum by going through the material in the evenings, because you have the material with you, just revising through. The best idea would be if two or three of you are staying in one place, two or three of you go together in the evening time, after dinner time, just go over the slides of today, of what you have done, and if there's any question, you note it down and you ask me the next day, right? So that's how we can get the best out of it. Okay, let's make a very quick rundown of the things. So today I'm going to start with what is optimization, what is its scope in practice. The time we have, we may not be able to finish everything, but I will skip it over for tomorrow. I briefly mentioned in my inauguration is that there are a lot of myths in industry about the use of optimization in practice. So I want to say why they think this way, what are we doing to change this. So some of those we'll just go through. I'll probably not able to go to the no freelance theorem, but we'll see. It's something that always keeps us in the right track. Okay, it's called no free lunch theorem. I will mention it when I get to that point, but this is a guiding factor that any optimization researcher these days get guided by. So you are taking the course should also know about it. So we'll talk about it when you get there. And then I'm going to be told, there's a spelling mistake here, but on optimization, steps of optimization methods. And in the exercise today, I'm going to give you a couple of problems to formulate the problems as an optimization problem. And I'll be there to guide you, but I want you to first try yourself. Okay, tomorrow we're going to talk about single variable unconstrained optimization. First I'll start with some optimality conditions, and then I'll talk about few algorithms that are classically motivated. Although I'm using the word here classical, they are not dead, okay? They are still used, because sometimes we think classical means gone past, but no. The reason I want to say classical is we're going to come back with some non-classical methods which are really fast taking over the optimization problems and solving. And those are like population-based methods, which I'm going to be talking about, I think, towards the later part of this week or early next week, probably later part of this week. We'll just see that. But classical methods are mostly point-based methods. So I'm going to differentiate the two methods, classical versus non-classical, and I'll go over that. But initially, I would like you to have the idea of how the whole optimization started, okay? And then what are the new stuff that will come later. So we'll start again very gently with single variable, just only one variable, so you understand everything about what is an optimization problem, what are the optimal properties of optimal solutions, and what are some algorithms, which are very easy to understand. Then we move to multivariable. Now we'll have multidimensional space. We can visualize up to three dimensions, but we'll go beyond three. We'll actually talk about two or three, but then extend it for higher dimensions, so you can see how things change, like how the optimality conditions change, and how the algorithms have to be changed as well. Again, I will stay ourselves with the classical methods. Then we'll become a bit more challenging, and we'll talk about constrained optimization. First two topics will be unconstrained, again, optimality conditions, duality theory that comes very handy for solving constraint problems. I'm just going to introduce you to that. Okay, and then the tomorrow's assignment will be on those topics, so there will be a little bit of math for tomorrow's exercise problem, manual calculations. On Wednesday, we'll talk about constraint algorithms, okay? And then there is a very important post-optimality analysis which again can provide you knowledge about your problem. That's called the sensitivity analysis, so we'll talk about that. Then we'll talk about a series of structured optimization algorithms, starting with linear programming, then quadratic programming, then integer programming. Has any of you done linear programming before, LP? Yeah, it comes in very various different courses, particularly if you're from IME, Industrial Management. You have to take such a course on operations research. So optimization is a bit more generic than just operations research. We cover both linear and nonlinear. But operations research field mostly talks about linear programming and to some extent quadratic programming. Okay, so we'll start with those there and then move to integer programming. And then on those topics there will be the exercise. Since it's 1.5 hour, the quiz would be about half the time, let's say 40 minutes, 45 minutes. So I will give you less problems for these topics, and we'll keep 45 minutes for the quiz. Okay. Then on Thursday, so first quiz we have is on Wednesday. Okay, but everything on that quiz will be covered, at least what we do today and tomorrow and the morning of Wednesday. So, but I'll try to make it more from the days before that we do that. Then we'll start the PoW. So we're starting population-based from Thursday already, okay? And then we'll talk about genetic algorithms, which is one of the ways to do non-classical optimization. We'll start with the simplest one called the binary coded GA, and then how to handle constraints, and some case studies, and there is a little bit of theory called schema theorem, which we'll talk about. Exercises will be on the integer programming that we did the day before, and binary coded GA that we'll be doing the same day. Then on Friday, we'll go a little more advanced, talk about real coded GA, which is a bit more advanced from binary coded GA. Then there are a few other real coded optimization, population-based optimization, like differential evolution, particle swarm, and evolution strategies. These are some of the methods that are quite popularly used these days. Then I will start the introduction of practicalities that we often face in real-world problems. One of the things is meta-modeling, which we'll talk to you then when I get there. Right now, I'm just telling you some of the topics. So again, the exercise will be on what we covered the previous day up to that day, okay? And there will be a quiz on genetic algorithm on Friday. So this week, we have two quizzes. One on Wednesday, one on Friday. Then we don't have any class on Saturdays and Sundays. And then Monday, Dilip is going to take the class on interactive evolutionary algorithms and scheduling evolutionary algorithms, and there will be exercise on those problems. I believe the day six exercise is not in the proceeding, so he is probably going to give you on that day itself. Okay, then day seven, I come back, and on Tuesday, that's Tuesday, and we start with large-scale optimization. You will be the first timer where I will present a billion-variable optimization algorithm. So far, the optimization has been practiced since early 60s, actually from about Second World War. Nobody has solved such a big problem. So this actually takes us a leap forward, showing that optimization can be used for very large-scale problems, because this had been a question to me from various fields, various people asking me, how big a problem have you solved? So this actually answers them that, yeah, we can go up to billion variable. But to solve a billion variable problem, there are a lot of hurdles. So I'm going to go over it so that you see what it takes to solve a large-scale problem. And then we'll stay with multimodal optimization, where there are multiple optimal solutions. Oftentimes, we have that in practice. That a design is good for a number of different ways. Number of different designs can be equally good. So how can you find all of them? Or how can you find, let's say, 4 or 5 of them or 10 of them so that now you can decide which one to put? So that comes under these multimodal optimization. So up to that point, we'll be covering single objective, finding one solution, one optimal solution, and we should be happy till that point. Now we are getting more and more challenging. And we are saying, no, we are not happy with one. If there are multiple solutions, give me number of solutions. I want to see if a gearbox looked like this. Is there another gearbox giving me the same kind of compactness but looks different? So I'm being a designer. I'm interested in seeing different solutions before I make up my mind which one to do. There are a lot of advantages, other advantages. Like if you are particularly, let's say, a practitioner and the lead company in that particular area, you can fool your competitor. As soon as you come up with new products, there are industries, there are companies who try to mimic you. They try to do reverse engineering, figure out how you're solving problems, and they come up with a mimicry of your solutions, right? And they try to sell it cheap. Oftentimes it happens. But if you're the leader and if you know multiple solutions to solve the same problem, you can fool them by every couple of months come up with a new design. And a lot of industries do that, right? And then your competitors or your followers just have no clue. How are they doing all this, okay? So when you have multimodal optimization, you learn that there exist number of designs having very similar performances. And since you found them, you can switch it. You can switch from one to the other just to confuse your competitors. So there are a lot of advantages. But again, it all goes back to knowledge. As soon as you find multiple solutions that are equally good, think about how much knowledge you can learn from all those solutions. So this course is not only about finding one optimal solutions, knowing some algorithms for this, which many courses will have, but I want to also stress on learning something from it, learning knowledge, discovery out of the problem. Then we'll move to another very important area, hierarchical optimization, which has a special name when you have two hierarchy called bi-level. And this is really taking shape. And in my lab back home is one of the places where we are leading in this area. We started a lot of work about 7-8 years ago. Now we've got about 4 PhD students working on it. So if you Google on bi-level, you'll have to come back to our site because most of the stuff we are doing. I would like to give you an introduction to that hierarchical optimization. Again, exercises will be on those topics. Wednesday, we'll go to even more practical stuff called multi-objective. Just outside at the coffee break, I was talking to Professor Shah and Das again, and they mentioned about, without my mentioning, they said that practice is full of conflicting objectives, competing objectives. Yes, they are. And then we have ways to handle them. So we'll talk about multi-objective. This is something I championed, started when I was in Kanpur back in 93. As soon as I joined with my first master's degree student, I took this up as a how to solve this multi-objective problem. So more than 20 years ago. And now this has become a field. Industries have graduated from single object to multi-objective. And many of the industries use our algorithms. Algorithm we're going to be talking about called NSGA2. Maybe some of you have heard, may not be. But this is one of the algorithms that has made multi-objective optimization not only popular, but useful in industry. And all these were developed while I was in Kanpur with students like you. Okay, so it's possible to do. That single paper of NSGA2, just to tell you how popular it is, has got now, I think, about 18,000 Google Scholar citation, just one paper. So you can think of the popularity of multi-objective optimization in practice. And I am particularly consultant of a few industries and software industries which does optimization software. They have their annual meetings, right, called users group meetings. Every time I go, every year I go, I see that they first only doing single objective, then move to 2 and 3 objectives. And from last year on, I've seen some of them using 5, 6 objectives. But we will talk about in this course some algorithms which can do about 15 or 20 objectives. Okay? Industries are not ready yet, but I think in a few years they are going to be there. And in my lab, we've started talking about 50 plus objectives. So there are problems which requires that many objectives. It's just a matter of time. Industries is funny. They closely follow what goes on. They will watch. Okay, so many industries, just the day before I came, there was a company called me and said, we're looking for solving about 11 to 12 objectives they have, and they couldn't find anybody else do it. So they bumped into our website, and they thought they called me to find out. I said, yeah, we have methods. We can solve 15 to 20 objectives. And then they wanted to discuss further. I said, okay, 2 weeks, I'll not be here. I said, after 2 weeks, we come back and talk about it, but they cannot wait. You see how much sacrifice I'm making, right, for you guys. So you have to really pay it back somehow by paying attention of what we'll be doing and going through all this. So they cannot wait because they also work on deadlines. And they just came to know that we can handle so many objectives which they have been looking for. So now they want to do this first shot to see what are different solutions to this problem that they're interested in. So industries are catching up very quickly. As soon as they, so if they don't find anything, they will say, okay, maybe the academics is not ready yet. But as soon as they find something, they would say, oh, here's the guy who can do it, and they will immediately jump into it. So in academics, we always try to keep ourselves ahead of what the practice is so that they get ideas, they can get into new things that that they may not be doing. But I know, as soon as I talk about optimization and multi-objective optimization, you will see what is the importance of having so many objectives. It just opens up another complete, another door for optimization. So there is another issue with the optimization is decision making, because by default, when you have multiple objectives, it gives you a number of solutions. So then the decision making becomes an important issue. So we are working on some of those, and I'm going to give you some introduction to that. This literature is far from being complete, okay? A lot of research still going on in this. So this is a very fertile area. The whole slide here is a fertile area to work on. So there will be exercises on these algorithms so that you can practice yourself also a little bit. Then Thursday, we're going to talk about performance measures. Because these are new, you will not be able to hear from too many people about this, so I decided to talk a couple of days on the multi-objective optimization. And it is also very much like research type of ideas. So many of you, I think, are graduate students right here. So if you're looking for a new topic to work on, or at least know so that you may be well advanced in your thesis and think of, okay, after I finish my thesis, I'm looking for ideas. So these are some of the things you can go get into. So this innovization I mentioned, which we're going to be talking about in a little bit of depth, and you'll see what I mean by knowledge discovery. With the availability of parallel computers these days, you need algorithms, optimization algorithms that can use take help of parallel computing or distributed computing. So I'm going to show you some ideas of how to do it. Okay, then this is the time when I was looking for a computer. Each of you should have, but we'll see. If you, all of you don't have it, we cannot arrange the computer system downstairs, then I'm going to just demonstrate here, and those of you can bring your laptop can bring it, and I can give you those codes, and you can try. Last class will be Friday, 8th July. We'll talk about these many objectives, going over to 15 plus objectives, and then few other practicalities, like uncertainty handling, which is a very practical thing. Again, I'm not going to describe today all of those. Dynamic optimization, where as you're optimizing, your objective objective function and constraints change with time. So you need to always trace back where the optimum is. Then multimodal, multi-objective optimization. We'll see how much time we have with this last day. But I would like to definitely show you a 14-objective application which I have recently done from New Zealand. It's a land use management problem. So we'll see that, and then I'll wrap up. There won't be any exercise that day, okay? Because we'll just finish after the morning session that day. Okay, so, and there's no final exam, okay? So there'll be four quizzes. I forgot to mention the quizzes this week, right? Do I have it here? Okay, I don't have it here. But there is one I mentioned on 1st July, but there should be, so that's the first this week. There should be two more, and I have another scheduled place I'm going to show you. So there'll be two more next week, okay? So attendance will be 20%. There is a paper that's floating around, so please put your name and sign there so that we know the attendance. There will be 9 exercises in total, right? Except the last day, and we will just take the best 8 out of it. So one you can afford to do not good, but others you try to do good. So, and that'll carry about 30%. And quizzes will be 50%, because that's how we get the individual assessment of you. So I keep a little more weightage for that. Okay. Any question about the organization of the course, or anything that you expected to learn from this course that I haven't covered here? No? Okay. You can ask me anytime. Stop me anytime as we go along. Okay, so I don't save it here. Now we start with the first lecture. Because we started late, I'm not going to give you any break today. We'll just go, so it's just another hour and 10 minutes, so I can do that. Okay. So what I'm going to do is talk to you about what is optimization, scope of optimization is in practice, variations of different kinds of optimization problems that we face in practice, and if time permits today, which I don't think, but we'll see, we'll talk about no free lunch theorem. Okay, any of you has taken optimization class before? Any optimization class? Okay, there are four of you. Are you from here or Kharagpur or no other places? Okay. So was it a full course on optimization or is it embedded in some other course?
Genetic algorithm.
You took a genetic algorithm course. How about you?
Optimal control.
Okay. And over here?
I learned it from online courses
you have done. You? Same online course.
Operations research and optimization.
What would you? Okay. Operations research, there is some optimization, right? But mostly linear and quadratic, right? Okay, but majority of you didn't have an exposure. So I will start knowing as if none of you know optimization, okay? So first, we need to go back many, many years before we want to trace back who was doing optimization at the earliest. And I found in 300 BC, okay, Euclid was talking about finding the word, this word minimal. Anything you see, the minimization or maximization, this is a generic, the generic word for these is called optimization, okay? The optimum can be a minimum or a maximum depending on are you trying to minimize your objective function or maximize your objective function. So he talked about if you have a line and there is a point, it could be two-dimensional or three-dimensional, if I want to now find the closest point on the line from the point, we are talking about some kind of optimization, right? That means we need to find the minimum distance. So he introduced this word minimum distance back then, long time ago, although he didn't formalize how to find it, but he at least gave a methodology to find it and talked about finding the importance of finding it. Euclid also did a lot of other things regarding optimization, like if you have a perimeter specified to you, so in this case, let's say perimeter is 1, 2, 3, 4, 4 times 4, 16, so 16 units. And you can have any rectangle that's perimeter is 16 units. What is the shape that's going to maximize the area? So he talked about specifying something, which now becomes like a constraint, like, so my perimeter is 16 is a constraint. And with that perimeter, I want to now maximize the area inside, and I want to make it a rectangle. These are some do's that you have to have. What area or what shape? Is it a rectangle? Is it a square? If it's a rectangle, what is the aspect ratio? If it's square, I know the aspect ratio is 1. So what is going to make it having the maximum area? You can formally do it using the optimality methodologies today, but you know that it's going to be a square, right? So here you can see the example. So some of these he talked about with geometry. He played with geometry where optimization is brought in. And that's why I said a little bit of knowledge of geometry will be helpful if you want to understand the optimization methods. Heron talked about light traveling in straight line, right? Light always goes from one point to another point in the minimum possible time. And it has to be a straight line then. But then when you go from one medium to another medium, the light has to refract. And it does in a way so that in its individual minima, it travels at a fastest speed, okay, from one point to the other. And that's how it has to go away from how it started. So that's why there is an incidence angle and there is a refractance angle, which are different because every medium, the light travels in a different way. So if you follow all these things, you can actually come up with Fermat's law. And this is one of the assignments you will have tomorrow, I think, to prove that that the light will follow the Fermat's law. Then fast forward to 17th and 18th centuries where most of the development has taken place. There are some nice applications that people have done. Kepler, for example, did come up with what, because wine production started around the same time, little earlier than that, but storing of wine was a big thing. Not in this country that much, but particularly in Europe. So they needed to find what are the optimal sizes and shapes of wine barrels so that it stays cool for a long time and still stored in a better way for a long time. So he helped calculate some of those things using not any formal method again, but the geometry and other stuff that the ideas came from the earlier works of people. He also did some non-numeric optimization, as Professor Das has been talking about. Particularly in an evening lecture, he talked about how can you choose a wife? That was back in 1611. I was asked this question actually some time ago on a television interview here, and I was taken out of the context. And he asked me, "Can I use your algorithm to choose my wife?" I said that would be dangerous to do, but then, but there are actually some methodologies which you can follow, and secretary, they actually, this problem is called secretary choice problem, but you can put it to anybody that you'd like to choose. So his optimum solution was this, that 36.8% spouses, or if you're a man, if you're choosing for a woman, 36.8% of the first 36.8% of them you reject. Okay, don't select. And then whoever comes first, you should choose. So don't take it and blame me later on for that purpose. But this was Kepler's optimal design, optimal solution to the choice problem. And he, of course, assumed a lot of things, that they can come in any order. There is no specific order they come and all that. So you need to read those fine lines of under what assumptions this is optimal. But you know, some such thing is what I also call as rule eventually. So you see what happens. He's trying to solve a particular problem. He first understood what the problem is, and then he posed it like a mathematics problem, and then he finds a solution. You need to, of course, read all the fine prints that I mentioned to you. But then you get a solution that is not contextual, right? I just explained to you in Word that first 36.8% people you meet, don't hire them if you're hiring a secretary, for example. Then the next one comes in for interview, hire them. That seems to have a mathematical property of being an optimum. If you assume they come in certain ways, you need to go back and look at all that. Now, once you found that result, you can now keep it as a rule base, that this is how I'm going to always choose, right? So that's the knowledge that you get from it, because this knowledge comes from not an arbitrary solution, but an optimal solution. Okay, so the innovization is sort of like this concept extended in a much more broader sense. We'll get there, but you see, optimal solutions you find for implementing, but if you try to then go and understand, they have a lot of information in them, which can be very, very helpful. So what about, like, if you are the company who discovered this rule that it works in most cases, obviously you're not going to publicize this, right? You're going to keep it as a trade secret of your company. And this is what I mean by being leader and understanding what is the fundamental behind these optimal solutions. Okay, then there are lots of different other people. Shape of a hanging chain to gradient becomes zero at the optimum. All these become calculus came up, and then optimization is related to calculus and everything. Koenig came up with a honeycomb material choice, the shape of that, and Lagrange came up with Lagrangian theorems that we have in optimization. So pretty fast things have evolved after that. Again, coming to 19th century, things become more and more mathematical. They try to connect one thing to the other, but I guess one of the greatest thing that has happened is the LP solver by Danzig, and the linear programming solver, which has helped a lot of companies, a lot of strategic companies. Like, the first time it was used was in the Second World War for resource allocation kind of problem. Cauchy came up with the steepest descent concept, which we'll be talking about. Optimization went into economics, which actually saw a lot of Nobel Prizes in the area, and applications in finance. Okay, 20th century, of course, these are some few things I'm saying I cannot fit in everything, but one of the theoretical development which the whole optimization literature is based on now is called Karush-Kuntakar conditions, KKT theorem, which I'm going to introduce to you. But this is the basic thing what anybody has to understand before you know anything about optimization. But then there are more formal theories that exist, which we'll not get into that. Every mathematics department in an engineering university or any university will have some people working on mathematical optimization. But their focus can be slightly different from what we'll be doing here. Their focus would be mostly to come up with theorems and proofs for certain classes of problems. Our focus is not that. Our focus is to come up with even an approximate solution. We don't care much about getting to the actual optimal solution. but something close to it will be okay. But how fast can we get there? How can we take care of all these practicalities and all that? So these are some names that I put here. By the way, Karmarkar, you see the name at the end. He was a student of IIT Mumbai. He was a PGM. He came up with an alternative to simplex method of linear programming. And his method is used for very large scale linear programming problem. He's back to India. He works in Mumbai these days. Okay, so there are some Indian contribution as well over here. Okay, so with that background, that seems to have a very, very long history and a lot of interest in math area mostly. We'll now get into some introduction to what is optimization and get into the engineering side of it. So first of all, there are a few things I put there in the first paragraph on red, and these are the things you have to pay attention. So optimization is a task. It's an effort that you have to make for searching a set of decision variables. So you need to first, in a problem, identify what are your decision variables, which would minimize or maximize one or more objective functions. So that means we're talking about some objective functions. And they have to, these variable combinations have to satisfy certain constraint functions as well. So there are three things: decision variables, objective functions, and constraint functions. These are essential for formulating an optimization problem. So in today's afternoon exercise, there are a couple of problems. You need to identify each one of them for the problems and then write them in mathematical form. Okay, so that is the task. So here I'm showing you a two variable problem. So there are two decision variables, x and y. Okay, this is a hypothetical problem. This doesn't represent any problem. This is just a mathematical problem I'm showing you here. You see the x and y space, right? So x and y space is this space, as you see. X is this direction, y is in that direction. So any point in this first quadrant here, I can give you a corresponding x and a y, right? It represents an x and y. Those are the specific values of x and specific values of y. Now that you've told me a specific value, I can actually think of a solution with those values. So x could be the dimension, let's say length of a beam, and y could be the diameter of the beam. Okay, so a beam is like a rod. I have a length and I have a diameter. If you give me these two, I can actually visualize. I can actually do a lot of things. I can actually find out how much it will going to weigh, because material I've assumed to be fixed, let's say. I can also figure out how much it's going to cost me from the material cost, and also maybe I need to turn it in a lathe, and how much from material to how much I've reduced, it gives me an idea how much it's going to cost me, right? So once, but the solution here is that beam, which has two parameters, x and y. If you give me one value of x and one value of y, I can fix that design. I can think of how much it's going to cost or how it's going to perform, right? So decision variables specify the design, okay? So x and y in this case are two. And I told you I'm going to show you a result eventually, and that's probably the climax of this course, is where the number of variables have gone to billion, not just two. So I'll obviously not be able to show you. And when three dimensions, I can barely show you, but anything more, I cannot show you. But most typical problems in practice has 10 plus object variables. So 10 to 50 is pretty common. Anything more than that comes, but as the number of variables increase more and more, they are rare and rare. But 100, 500, 1,000 is not very uncommon. But in all our lectures here, I'm going to keep only two variables so that I can show it on two dimensions so you can get the idea. All right. So now, after we talked about the variables, the question comes of constraint. So there could be a constraint function like here. I'm showing you this ellipse here. So the constraint will say, constraint actually makes this whole region of possible solutions into two classes. One is the feasible class, the other is the infeasible class. In this case, this constraint may say that all the points inside the ellipse are feasible. So that means outside is infeasible, inside is feasible. It could have been the other way around, but that is determined by the problem. And the constraints could be stress constraints, or constraints could be space constraints, or whatever. So here, when I showed you the XY first quadrant, that's my search space. That's called the search space. That means I can search anywhere in the first quadrant of X and Y. Why first quadrant? Why not second, third, fourth? Anybody has any clue?
Dimensions cannot be negative.
Exactly. Dimensions, I've talked to you, X is a dimension and Y is a dimension. They cannot be negative. That's why you're in first quadrant. But there could be another problem where you can have negative values. Okay, so in that case, we will have negative. We will have maybe all four quadrants. So it depends on the problem. But that's my search space. Now a constraint comes and says, okay, now that you have this broad search space, not everything is feasible. So the constraints will say what is feasible. There could be one or more constraints, okay? And every constraint has to be satisfied before you get a feasible solution. So basically, we have to take a union of all the constraint feasible spaces to get the overall feasible spaces. Constraints can be of two types, equality type and inequality type. We'll get to that later. And then the third thing here is the objective function, which you see here as the surface. Okay, so any xy you choose which is feasible, that means which is inside that ellipse, now I have to know what is the objective function. Let's say I'm trying to minimize this surface, this function. I'm trying to find out what value on that surface is going to give me minimum function value. So any point here, for example, this point here has a function value of this much height. Okay, so that's the function that describes, once you give a x and y, the function gives me what is the function value. And I'm trying to minimize and trying to be within the feasible region. So in this particular case, this point here has the minimum height to the surface. So that's my optimal solution. So the point O here is the optimal solution, right? And I don't know that beforehand. Okay, I have the whole search space to search on. So an algorithm has to start from somewhere and has to move in iterations and plan of going to reach this optimal point. So that's the task of any optimization algorithm. But here we are talking about an optimization problem. As soon as you have a problem, which means your fxy is defined, your constraint functions are defined, your xy's are identified, and your objective function and constraints are functions of these variables, you have an optima. You have already determined the optimum. Only thing is you don't know it. So when I talk about optimality conditions, these are mathematical conditions applied on this function f and constraint functions to say what needs to be satisfied before you have that optimum. If this point has to satisfy, this O has to satisfy some conditions. So those are optimality conditions. But those are for theory purposes. You cannot use them in practice, those optimality conditions. That's why you need to use an algorithm. Because theory is difficult to apply, you need to use algorithm to go from something that was arbitrary to near the optimum. Is that clear? Okay. So then we move to the next slide. Okay, this was the optimum I was talking about. So now here, I'm giving you an overall sketch of the mathematical nonlinear programming problem. X is usually at the decision variable vector. It's usually n dimensional. N is the number of variables. We are trying to find x star, which is that O point, the x optimum. It's not any arbitrary point. It's the optimum point. That's going to minimize fx. So your job will be to supply what is that fx, because it comes from the problem you're trying to solve. And there can be inequality constraints. Most of the lectures, we're going to talk about greater than equal to, but you can have less than equal to, and you can convert greater than equal to less than equal to or less than to greater than by multiplying both sides by minus 1, right? So we could do that. Then there are equality constraints, which has to be exactly satisfied. The left-hand side should be equal to 0. These kind of constraints also come in practice. And then sometimes there are variable bounds. Sometimes it says x cannot be less than 0. So you have a lower bound of 0, or x can be between 2 to 10, for example. So 2 becomes the lower bound, 10 becomes the upper bound. And every variable can have different limits. Some variables you may not know, so you don't have to specify. But this is by far what you get as an optimization problem. If everything is linear here, all the functions f, g, h, then it's called a linear programming problem. Okay? If fx is quadratic, that means it's quadratic, it has maximum x square power, and all your constraints are linear, then it's called a quadratic programming problem. Now, fortunately, some problems from practice has these kind of structured properties. If you see that kind of properties in your problem, you shouldn't think of any other method. You should just go and apply those methods, because those linear programming, quadratic programming methods are geared towards solving those problems specifically. They don't do a very good job in solving other problems. But here, in this slide, you see a very generic structure. It's called a nonlinear programming problem. Okay, so F, G, H can be anything. Let's take an example. Say we have to design a beer can. So here is a can. I'm representing it with two dimensions, H and R. I could think of lots of other variables, right? Like, for example, thickness of the can. Okay, what else can I think of as a variable? Yeah. Okay, we go back. If any of the functions is nonlinear, it's called a nonlinear programming problem. All are linear, it's called a linear programming. Okay? Now, usually the objective functions are more nonlinear than constraints, but there is no such structure. For another problem, it could be the other way. But most problems that we solve, objective function is the most complex form of the function, and constraints are usually manageable. Okay? But if any of them is nonlinear, it's a nonlinear programming problem. Okay. Please raise your hand or ask question if you have anything to ask. But here, let's go over in an interactive mode a little bit. So I'm introducing you to the problem. It's a beer can that you have to design, and I told you only two variables. So there are three things you have to identify, right? If you have to optimize this, first is what is my decision? What are my decision variables? So I mentioned to you H and R. These are the two basic things I need. How much the diameter should be and how much should be the height. So R instead of diameter, I'm calling the radius as a variable. And height as another variable. Somebody said thickness, or I said thickness is another variable. Thickness of the can, right? What else can you think of as a variable?
Material.
What makes it aluminium? Is it copper? Is it steel? Okay, that's good. Another? Any other?
Cost.
No, cost is not a variable. Can you vary the cost and have a design? No. So that's a good point that you mentioned, because variables are usually dimensions or manufacturing units that is completely in your hand. You can change it. Cost becomes an outcome. When I go from maybe aluminium to steel to make the thing, maybe the cost will go up, but cost becomes as a byproduct. But material is what as an input I'm giving. So all the variables are like inputs, like what is in my control? What can I do to change the design? Cost I cannot change. Cost will become an outcome. If I change my design, I will see the cost is getting changed, but that's not a variable. Okay, any other?
Cost is a constraint.
Yeah, cost can be a constraint. You want to say, I don't want to manufacture it by more than 10 bucks, 10 rupees, let's say. So that's your, that comes as a constraint function, but that becomes an upper right-hand side of those constraints, that it cannot be more than, or it should be less than equal to 10, so that way. But variables. Not objective at this point. We're just still talking about variables. So let's see how far can we think, okay? Good point. Shape can be a variable. It need not be always cylindrical. That's how you see all the Coca-Cola cans and all that. But why do we have to restrict ourselves to that? Maybe the optimal design is not that. Or if it is, maybe let the optimization tell us that it has to be a cylindrical can. But that's a good point. So shape could be another thing. Now, as soon as we say shape, how can we describe, because shape becomes like a non-numeric thing, right? So how can we be more specific about the shape and what are my numeric variables? Huh? Volume again becomes an outcome, right? Once you tell me the shape and dimensions, I can give you the volume, yeah? It's a hollow thing because I'll be storing liquid inside, so it's hollow inside. There is a top on the and the base. Yes. Right. You are talking about some other shapes of the top and the bottom. Yeah, that could be another variable as well. Yeah, but just for your first thing you said about the shape, how can we describe a shape? So what kind of shape are you thinking of, if not cylindrical? You're always thinking of axisymmetric? Or are you thinking of square? Are you thinking of hexagonal? Well, it's up to you, right? Because you are designing, if you want to explore everything, you have to keep this very generic. If you want to say, no, it has to be axisymmetric because it doesn't matter how you hold it, you can rotate it and you can hold it still, it would serve the purpose, then you should make an axisymmetric one. Now, axisymmetric, now what I need an area, and then I can rotate it about the center. So how do I specify the area? It could be any curve. So a curve, it could be a Bezier curve. So I can put some 3, 4 Bezier points, and I can coordinate of those points can become my variables. So you change any of the coordinates, you have a different curve. And one of them will be a straight line, which will give me the circle, give me the cylindrical shape. So that's a way to think about, to make it very generic, okay? So like that, yeah, you can think of many, many other things. For example, I can add a few other, like what should be the texture of the outside? Yeah, should it be very smooth or rough so that I hold it? What would be the color, okay? Because that could be another thing which is, if it depends on the objective functions that I have, may not be so important, but you can think of some of those things as well. Could it be like a tapering thing that should end up to a point, or it should be, can be a it's called a frustum of a cone, frustum, right? So all these things can come in, how you can go in for about 10 to 12 to 15 different variables even for this simple problem. But one of the thing that I caution is that, yeah, you can think if you really have to do it, don't just make the problem unnecessarily hard. As you're adding more and more variables, you're making the optimization algorithm work more, right? And find out the best design, the optimal design. So it may take more time to optimize. If you don't have to, don't do it. But if you really think, yeah, I need to know once and for all, because every day I design this, I need to know is cylinder the right way to do. So yeah, do it once, and then you have to be prepared to give more time for the optimization algorithm to do it. So come up with as minimum number of variables as possible. So let's say we keep ourselves only to these two variables. Then comes the next question, constraint. So now the constraint, as soon as you've designed the variables, that means all other that you did not take as a variable have to be now fixed to certain value. So one of the things for the shape, I'm going to fix it as a cylindrical. Thickness, I'm going to fix it, let's say, 0.5 mm. Okay, I fixed everything. Color and all that I fixed. Only variable is H and R. You can change H. If you change H longer and higher, you'll get a longish looking cylinder. If you make R longer and longer, you're making a fat kind of a can, right? So that's how they change. Now, what could be some constraints now? So constraints and objective function are now going to be functions of H and R. Other things being constant, that's going to be function of H and R. So what could be a constraint? Volume inside. You want, somebody said that, we want at least certain volume inside. So let's say I want 330 milliliter, because that's usually the Coke cans are, okay? So we'll have H and R combination so that the volume inside is 330. So what type of constraint is that? Is it equality or inequality? Equality. If you want exactly 330, it has to be equality. But is that a requirement? So what would be the constraint? So it'll be an inequality, but what kind? So you want volume should be less than equal to 330? Okay, let's discuss that. What if you do less than equal to, say I've got, okay, I need to then talk to you about objective function first. Okay, so let's hold on the less than equal to and greater than equal to, and we'll come back to that. Now let's talk about objective function. Okay, what other constraints there can be? Volume is one, of course. What other? Upper and lower limit on the dimensions. Yes, we can definitely, we don't want to make it so thin that I cannot hold it, okay? Or so thick that, again, I cannot hold it. Or, but what could be other constraints? Stability could be one thing, right? So you have, if it's too narrow and long, it has a chance of tipping over, and you don't want that to happen. So stability, we can compute where the CG is versus how much can you turn before the CG goes outside the base, and then you lose the stability. So all these, you being the designer of this can, you have to think about all this, okay? Okay, so there could be a lot of such constraints that can come in. But let's talk about objective function now. So what could be an objective function? Now somebody said cost, that comes in, okay? Now that I have I've thought about the decision variable and the constraints, what I come up with should minimize, let's say, the cost of fabrication. So cost can be related to the surface area, so how much material I'm putting. So I have a cylindrical area, and then I have two top, right? So I can sum up all this area, and I want to minimize that. That'll probably be proportional to the cost, right? So that's my objective function. Let's keep it that way. I can use some other objective function as well. But Now getting back to the less than equal to and greater than equal to for the constraints and on the volume, what if I have this objective function, which is the overall material that I have to put here to be minimized, obviously, right? I don't want to maximize the material I'm putting in. I want to do it with minimum amount of area so that I spend less money. More material, more area means more material means more money, right? So more cost. Now, can you revise? Is it going to be the area, the volume inside should be less than equal to 330 or greater than equal to 330? What if you do less than 330? The optimal solution is h equal to 0, r equal to 0, because you don't have a can. You don't spend any money, and nobody can beat that, right? But then I have not achieved anything. It's a trivial, we call it a trivial solution. Oftentimes we get into this trivial solution. That means you have not gone and put a very crucial constraint if that kind of solution comes up. Okay, so then you have to go and see what constraint it's that I didn't put. Okay, so it has to be greater than or equal to 330, okay? So this is how you formulate a problem. So here is the mathematical formulation. I mentioned some of the other things that you may want to use as variables or parameters. In this case, we choose the diameter and height. I have chosen aluminum with some thickness. And the constraint function is shown here, right? The G function is given here. You see the volume here has to be greater than or equal to 330. And the objective function is the pi dh, which is the cylindrical area, plus 2 times pi d square by 4, which are the two top and the bottom lead, right? And then I put some variable bounds on each of the diameter and the height to make it more reasonable. So once you specify like this, now you have formulated the optimization problem. Now I can go and use an algorithm to give me d star and h star, starting from any arbitrary solution. Okay, so that's the job of the algorithm. Don't try to think of yourself, what is the d and h, but it's the algorithm's job to find it. Your job is to formulate the problem so that every constraint, valid constraint that are needed are here. Now, you can help the algorithm by many ways. First thing, as I said, reduce the number of variables as low as possible without sacrificing on the complexity of the problem. Second thing is, every optimization algorithm requires you to supply at least one starting point. If you have some knowledge, let's say there is an existing can available in the market and you want to improve on it, right? You can measure those dimensions and provide that as an initial solution rather than an arbitrary solution, right? And then the algorithm will, starting already from a good solution, it will take less time or less iterations to get to the optimum.